a break. Give me a break. Break me off a piece of that interest rate. Or you could say, give me a break on the headlines of the articles talking about inflation.
What do you
think about that, Tori?
I'm ready to lose my mind. I'm sitting here looking at, you know, here today in the Wall Street Journal, inflation cooled slightly last month, keeping the Fed on track to raise rates. And all we've been reading for the last quarter is how the Fed needs to raise rates because of inflation gathering steam. Okay, let's just tell the truth. They need to raise rates. All right, we get it. So don't publish conflicting headlines.
Right, only within a month of each other?
Yeah, back in February, fears that rising inflation would prompt the Federal Reserve to pick up the pace of rate increases in 2018.
And now what are they saying?
Everybody, be careful what you're reading. They're saying raise interest rates because inflation cooled. It's not as high as they thought it was going to be. Look, the fact of the matter is we know they need to raise interest rates because they are in a corner. You know, monetary, economic, financial turmoil is being brushed over. It's being painted over. They're hiding it as best they can. They're hiding debt. They're hiding interest rate problems. They have nowhere to go. If they don't get interest rates up to a manageable level for the next crisis, that arrow isn't even there in the quiver for them to pull out next time.
Right, because what other arrows do they have?
Oh.
Right. What else are they supposed to do except lower interest rates on the next crisis?
Double their balance sheet from $4.5 trillion to $9 trillion.
They did that last time.
Yep.
From one to four?
It actually probably tripled. I think it was about 1.5 to 4.5. So nearly a triple. So you're right. Sorry. Give me a break. We can move on to the metals, but thanks for letting me vent for a sec.
You're right, Tori. I think that in anticipation of the next crisis, they're going to be raising interest rates. But in doing so, are they actually going to cause the next crisis?
Such a good question. I mean, it's absolutely a market-wide effect when you start raising rates, right? I mean, from the core lending rate all the way through the ripple effect of everything that people borrow, all credit, right? All mortgages, everything that they end up extending credit through get more and more painful. That slows down the economy. This is a credit-driven economy, and it has been for two decades, right? It's something that really the Clinton administration started, and it hasn't cooled off. They did not let it wash out in 2008 and 9 and 10. As a result, they're trying to keep this credit bubble going, and in order to manage things when the crisis gets really bad again, they have to be able to lower rates.
Yep. Moving on to the markets, gold has been kind of stuck in a range here, just like the dollar, just like some of the stock market. And we're, I think, a little bit on hold, waiting again. I'm going to reiterate that from a couple of weeks ago, waiting to see which direction the markets are wanting to go from here. So, Miles, run with gold. What do you want to say?
Yeah, Robert, I think since we started this show back last January, this may be about as flat as the precious metals markets have been. We did have a little bit of kicking around of price on the CPI news release. What was that, Tuesday, I think?
Right.
But we had a pretty decent drop in the dollar, rebounded back up, and then continued falling. Gold did the opposite, popped up, came back down, and continued rising. I think everything, again, hinges on what the U.S. dollar is going to do, where the equity market's going to go. The equity market's not going to make a decision until the market as a whole has ironed through some of the things you guys were just talking about in regards to interest rates. So obviously the stock market has no growth potential right now just on its own merit. So the question ends up being, where's the money going to come from that's going to push that equities market higher, that's going to push the price of gold higher, that's going to push the dollar lower if it comes from an inflationary source?
It's not going to come from Berkshire Hathaway because Warren Buffett made it clear that he wasn't buying. He thought things were overvalued and he has a lot of cash. So he's not buying. I'd probably follow him.
So you guys are talking about it being very flat, and yet you mentioned some movement here on the dollar. Everything has been less than 1%, right? Yeah, we had some dollar reaction, but we barely got above 90 for just a blip on the radar, right? We're right back down below 90. The dollar is showing no bullish strength to me. And if you really put a lot of weight behind these interest rate discussions, then the dollar would be rallying more than it did.
Absolutely.
That's false news.
That's right.
That's fake news to me. So then let's look at what the underlying issue is. They know the economy's not healthy. Right now we've got the Atlanta Fed that was calling for 5.4% GDP gain. And on Wednesday now it says that growth will likely be just 1.9%, right? JP Morgan and Goldman Sachs both see slowing growth, 2 to 1.8%. That's not good economic news, you guys. That's why we have stock market volatility. That's why the metals are flat, because things aren't reacting the way they normally do because you get a bunch of fake news getting spread.
Well, and this is where the strategic and thoughtful investor can make an educated decision based on the probability of some of these things happening over the next 6-12 months. You know, my big fear when we look back at what the precious metals market did, let's say 2008, 2009, 2010, what you're looking at is panic investing. What you're looking at last year in, say, Bitcoin, panic investing. What you can do right now is allocate a portion of your assets the correct directions and make strategic, reasonable, thoughtful, managed decisions while the markets take these brief respites from their directional moves, and just reallocate your positions towards something that makes sense without making emotional decisions.
Do you guys remember about 9-10 years ago, we did a DVD that was titled When Greed Turns to Fear? And that's exactly what you're alluding to, Miles. If you make moves now, this is the time of year to sort of really analyze your portfolio structure. How well are you diversified, right? What portion does cash play? What portion do equities play? What portion do tangible physical commodities or precious metals play? And get that balance now, because the last thing you want to be doing is that emotional investing you're talking about. Either there's greed driving the market, like what we saw with Bitcoin and the cryptocurrencies there for a while, or there's fear driving the market. And you don't want to be involved in either one of those.
No, the worst thing you can do, the worst type of investor you can be, is an events-driven investor. You can follow the fundamentals and make long-term decisions. You can follow the technicals and make medium to short-term decisions. But if you're sitting around waiting for something to emotionally push you in a direction, it's already way too late to have made a decision. So we know most of our listeners, anybody who's taking the time out of their week to come and listen to a show like this, obviously has already taken those types of steps, probably already sat down and talked to, say, a professional investment advisor or a precious metals broker like we are, to discuss some of those strategies, both short and long term. But we definitely encourage you, while we have these lulls in the market, while you have a moment where the US dollar is deciding up or down and we all think down, while the equities market is deciding up or down and we all think down, while precious metals are deciding where to go, while interest rates are deciding where to go, while the market's deciding where to go and the average person is sitting on the sidelines going, well, I'm just going to wait and react, go ahead and make a decision now, or at least get your ducks in a row so you know how you're going to react given certain situations.
Miles, you mentioned that this may have been the least volatile precious metals market we've seen in the last year, but gold was up, what, 10% this last year. In the last few years, we bottomed with gold at 1,050, and we've been making very constructive progress.
Over 25%.
Yeah, it's stair-stepped up from 1,050 into the 1,100s, into the 1,200s, now we're into the 1,300s. I think we're building this base for the next huge wave in gold. I think that's illustrated by the first wave in gold being from, you know, early 2000s. Then you had kind of a peak, pulled back about half that move, had another big wave. We've pulled about half that move, and we're building a constructive pattern here. And this is the time to be allocating into it. That third wave that I'm talking about is what Dave McAlvany talks about in an article that he wrote in the Intelligence Advisor. We're going to put that out there as a free copy to anyone who wants to call in the McAlvany Intelligence Advisor. It's a few pages. Dave talks about the geopolitical circumstances that is the catalyst for this next third wave. The third wave is always the largest, so you want to be preparing for that. You want to be in the market for that next launch higher with the gold price. The inflation-adjusted number for gold right now is around $2,500, $2,600. So sitting here at half of that price, that's where we're going, and probably going to be going a lot higher than that on this third wave. That third wave is going to draw in the public into the market. Anyway, call us for that issue. We will send you a free copy of the McAlvany Intelligence Advisor. Dave's article's in there. And
either mail or email. We're happy to just make
sure,
it easy.
Yeah. Sure. So 800-525-9556. We'll send you a free copy.
Hey, and let's not forget that gold still hasn't put in a lower price this year either. So we can talk about how boring the price action has been, but we opened the year at 1302 and we haven't been below that yet.
Good point, Miles. Yep. And I think that that is a sign of strength. I think the inverse of that would be your US dollar action.
Sign of weakness.
Every single time the dollar has tried to rally in the last year and 2 or 3 months, every single time it tries to rally, it doesn't even get back up to any trend line. It's not like it's rallying a little bit and then starting another wave down. It just fails altogether and goes lower. That's what we're seeing again here. It couldn't even hardly get up to 91 range. The trend line's above that. So the dollar's weak, and it's showing that fundamentals are gold's going to be strong with that dollar weak.
Market volatility in the equities market, same thing. It creates an air of instability and uncertainty, and that's when gold thrives. And even if it's not taken off and running, to your point, Miles, it's very, very stable. Well, it does better in times of deflation than inflation.
So not only do we have market instability, currency instability, geopolitical instability, we've even got domestic political instability, and the fistfights taking place in Washington, in the Capitol right now, are certainly not giving the average American a sense of comfort.
Well, Miles, to that point, it's not just the average American, it's the media. The mainstream media doesn't know how to report on this stuff, right? I mean, they want to give Trump a black eye, and yet they really can't because they never supported most of his administration anyway. But we do have 11 senior Trump administration officials now let go since he took the presidency. So yeah, you're right, that is an uncertainty. It's not just American uncertainty, it's global citizen uncertainty. They do not know where things are going politically in the United States. But I will say this, as Bill King put it, there's no more Mr. Nice Guy. He is cleaning house. He's going to get the people that he wants in there. He tried to go the establishment route, but he does have an agenda. And, you know, I'm as unclear what direction it's going to go as anybody is. All I know is that changes are being forced and there's a heavy hand.
With that, and with talking about taking a break, we're going to give you guys a little bit longer of a break between this week's show and next week's show. I think we have a few things right in the middle of the week next week. So you may see the show post Friday or even Saturday. So we'll see you then. Thanks for listening.
As always, if you like what you heard, hit that subscribe button, ring the bell so you get notifications every time we have a new show come up. You can always check us out at McAlvanyICA.com or give us a call, 1-800-525-9556. Thanks again for listening.
Have a great week.